There's a rumble in the sky and all the world can hear it call. They shudder at the fury of the mighty Thunderball.
Thunderball.
The power of her engines now is drowned in the sea. But the deadly force from within her is somewhere running free.
Run free.
Thunderball, your fiery breath can burn the coldest man. And who is going to suffer from the power in your hand?
Hey, everybody, and welcome to a new show on the Pop Culturally Insensitive Network entitled Cinematic TnA. And that's not a sex thing.
It could be.
It could be, but it's not. It's.
We're not judging what you get off on. Some people want to watch Gone with the Wind and rub one out. It's fine.
Yeah,
it's cinematic TNA. It's fine.
Yeah, bro. But it's really supposed to be our names, because he's Tom Lorenzo and I'm Anthony DiCaprio.
Yeah, we're clever like that.
Yeah, know, we're...
For fourth graders.
Yeah, man. We're all about those, you know, puns or whatever the fuck you call it.
Yeah, but basically, basically what we're going to be doing with this new show is, as a contrast to our other show, this is going to be a specific show where each week we will be diving into a specific topic and really diving into it. So,
like balls deep into it.
Yeah, we're going to get detailed and really discuss a lot of the nitty-gritty about it and our feelings on it and really just get into it more than we really can on the other show.
We're going to get dick deep in cinema, guys.
We're going to treat cinema like Sean Connery treats a woman and go dick deep sometimes without its consent.
Yeah, exactly.
Speaking of waka waka.
this week's topic
is the first of three.
The next couple of weeks are actually going to be this.
Just
James Bond related.
Yeah, leading into Spectre.
Yeah, because Spectre's going to be...
like 2 weeks from now.
Is it really 2 weeks from now? Holy shit. That's
well,
crazy.
Honestly, at this point, it's more like a week and a half, kind of.
Oh, jeez. I got to watch all the Daniel... Well, we're doing that anyway. Yeah, so we're watching a bunch of Bond stuff.
I actually watched Quantum earlier with Lauren.
Yeah? Nice.
Yeah, it's not bad. She actually liked it a lot.
I barely remember it. I gotta watch it again.
We'll get into that more next week since
That'll
be the Craig trilogy.
But this week we decided to tackle, basically it's the same movie, Thunderball and Never Say Never Again.
Yeah, and we chose these two movies out of the lot because it ties very specifically into why Spectre is even happening this year. Basically, before Bond even made it to cinema, Ian Fleming was writing his books, and he had a friend, a writing partner of sorts, and they were spitballing ideas. And one of those ideas became Thunderball the book, which then became the movie Thunderball. But that writing partner, Kevin McClory, didn't get the credit or the payment that he was due. And so he sued the ever-loving shit out of Eon Productions, Albert Broccoli, and that whole crew. And he won. So he got the rights to Spectre and Ernst Stavro Blofeld. So that is why we haven't seen either of those two organizations / masterminds in a official James Bond movie until now, since the lawsuit was either rescinded or the family made a deal with the Broccolis to allow them to have the rights back again, which is odd. Well, not odd, which leads to an odd side note in cinema history, in that in 1983, they made a remake of Thunderball, this guy Kevin McClory, and somehow he got Sean Connery back.
Yeah, I don't know how the fuck he managed that one.
I mean, if I had to guess, it was basically saying to Connery, hey, look, we can try to fuck over the Broccoli's by releasing a competitive Bond movie the same year Octopussy comes out. And if you know anything about Connery, he hated the fucking Broccoli family, and he must have been on board for that.
Oh, he hated Broccoli.
Oh, so fucking much. But, I mean, this seems to be the best first episode to dive into just because of the specific history of why this happened and why it's only taken till now to get Spectre back.
Yeah, man.
So we watched both of them within the last week or so.
Mm-hmm.
Actually watching Thunderball together.
Oh, yeah.
And, well, let's just... let's talk about Thunderball first, since that's the first in the chronology of the Bond movies. What did you think about Thunderball? Or let's say that before watching it, what were your memories of Thunderball? And then I guess how do you now see it with a fresher eyes?
Well, here's my thing with Thunderball. I actually saw Austin Powers as a kid. Before I watched Thunderball,
I'm the same. I saw all three Austin Powers honestly before I ever saw a James Bond movie. Maybe excluding GoldenEye.
I think the first actual James Bond movie I saw, I think, was Goldfinger, and then GoldenEye. But then my dad always said to me Thunderball is my favorite, and then he just happened to buy it and put it on. After I had seen Austin Powers. So I was just watching and I was like, all this shit is in Austin Powers. So it because of that, it was hard for me to appreciate it, I guess.
No, I could I very much understand that. Austin Powers kind of did what Blazing Saddles did to the Westerns.
Yeah, exactly.
It kind of killed it. I mean, that's pretty much why, Die Another Day became such the mess it was. It became so much more obvious a joke.
Yeah, yeah.
And why the Daniel Craig movies became so much more serious. It's like, all right, Austin Powers showed how ridiculous these movies are.
Yeah, exactly.
We gotta steer away from all that silly shit.
Right, and then, yeah, I mean, listen, I when I was a kid, it was tough to watch it really because it's pretty long, dude. It's long. Well, it's got some slow-ass parts to it.
It's also dated as fuck.
Yeah, it's pretty dated. It didn't, I mean, some of those, some of those Sean Connery ones are dated, but this one really, you could see it a lot.
Well, Dr. No, I think, is the most dated. It's almost, it's kind of almost unwatchable because it's they didn't know what they were doing.
Yeah.
They were making all that shit up as they went.
Right.
And really the only watchable thing for me is Connery. The rest of it's really slow and kind of plotless and really just...
Yeah. They didn't really, get their strides yet.
Nah, but I mean, for the first one, you get it's all right, they're figuring it out. It's the 60s. They basically invented the action movie.
Oh, yeah, essentially.
I mean, at least the big budget action movie, but I get, before that it was monster movies or gangster flicks to get your jollies out.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, I appreciate why people love it.
Oh yeah, most definitely.
Yeah, because you see that scuba fight at the end, and then throughout it, that must have been, especially for my dad. He saw it. I think he was six. He was 6 years old seeing that shit in the movie theater.
I can see
why he's got fond memories of it.
Oh, I mean, we were even talking about it while we were watching it, because it's really slow and kind of aggressively, drops the movie's pace to a crawl.
Yeah.
But just you think about it on a technical sense, and you're Jesus Christ, this, what, people definitely didn't see shit. This was 2 years before, I think 3 years before 2001.
Yeah, it was very, very impressive, man. Considering, there were sharks and fucking...
Oh, everything was practical.
It was yeah, man. The Sharks is friggin' like 1,000 guys, not 1,000, but you know, like over 20 dudes probably in a pool somewhere in a studio, just, you know, pretending to fight each other underwater. It's like pretty nuts.
I mean, just a little side tangent. I was thinking about that watching The Creature from the Black Lagoon today, and that was from the 50s.
Yeah, I haven't seen that in a long ass time.
Just a lot of shit underwater, but yeah, back to Bond. You watch those now, and you got to think about the time they were doing it, and like all that shit they were doing was never done before. Like they're doing crazy car stuff, crazy stunts, jumping, fighting, and a lot of it may look dated now, but you think about it then, like all those guys were in danger doing that shit.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's unreal, dude. It's like I don't understand how nobody. Somebody had to get hurt or messed up.
I mean, yeah, people probably got hurt, but I mean, I don't think anybody's died ever making a Bond movie.
Oh, that's very impressive.
I mean, which is kind of crazy when, like, what, 2 years ago, somebody died making an Allman Brothers biopic?
Yeah, really?
Yeah, someone got hit by a train.
Holy shit.
It was the,
I didn't even know they were making an Allman Brothers biopic, period.
Well, I don't think they are anymore because the director went to jail for it.
Shit.
For negligence, because they weren't supposed to be filming on train tracks, and the DP had her headphones on and she couldn't hear anything, and she just got blasted by a train.
Holy shit, that's awful.
Yeah, everyone thought so. Like the director went to jail because they didn't have the permits to be there.
Fucking A. Guerrilla filmmaking, huh? Filmmaking gone wrong.
Sometimes it bites you in the ass.
Jesus.
But I guess, you know, when you have the money that these Bond guys did, because I think the budget for this movie was like $7.5 million for 1965. That's a lot of fucking money.
I mean, it shows, dude. It's very impressive for the time period.
Because not only just the stunts, but like it is just a good-looking movie. Like they.
Oh, yeah, man.
Like, I mean, it is sexy. Like, that's what those movies were going for, and they nailed it.
Yeah, I mean, some things don't really work anymore, like the whole spa thing.
Oh, yeah, the spa thing's silly.
Like when he's just on the, I don't know, what is it, the spine stretcher?
They call it the rack.
Yeah, the rack, and then he's like just moving really fast. It's like, he's in danger.
I mean, so, yeah, a lot of that's, because that goes to a lot of their, like, that they're figuring out these action shit out as they go.
Yeah.
Where it's really just, they kind of speed ramp it. And it doesn't look that great now.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, oh, this is just fast forward.
Exactly. Yeah, there was a lot of scenes like that in that movie, like in the car chases, some of the fight scenes.
Yeah, and you know, obviously for a movie in the 60s, a lot of the fashion's really silly, like Connery's short shorts.
Oh yeah, and
his never-ending supply of short shorts.
Yeah, and his never-ending supply of pastel shirts. Just like brightly colored shirts. Unreal. And also, it's just funny too, like, they're in the Bahamas. I think I saw one native Bahamian person.
No, there was, because remember what, during the parade
scene? Oh, yeah, no, you're right. I'm thinking of Never Say Never.
No, yeah, that's the one that has no color.
There was nobody in there. No black people were in that movie.
Well, it's the 80s, you know, Reaganomics, black people suck, you know.
Jesus Christ.
I don't think so, but, you know, hey, fucking Reagan, man.
Yeah.
But,
fucking Reagan.
Yeah, so, I mean, rewatching it now, did your opinion on the movie grow, or did you think of it less?
A little bit of both, honestly, if that makes sense. Because, like, it lessened because, like, you know, it's not, I mean, someday I'll watch it again, but I'm not, you know, if I have to pick a Bond movie, I'm not going to pick Thunderball over, you know, there's a whole other slew of them I'd rather watch than Thunderball.
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
Yeah, but from a technical standpoint, I definitely appreciate it way more than I used to.
Well, I mean, just because, I mean, for me, when I went through them all a few years back and started watching them, that was the first dip because, you know, you went from Dr. No to From Russia With Love to Goldfinger, and there was this rise.
Yeah.
But Thunderball was the first, like, dip, and you go, okay, maybe they're running out of steam. Because yeah. It's way too long.
Uh-huh.
The pacing is really slow. The underwater stuff, technically great, but just drags the movie down.
It does, because it's not... I mean, it's not, like, very exciting. Because, I mean, all you don't have... You can't hear them talking to each other. Because they're all underwater and shit.
And it really is just guys underwater floating at each other.
Yeah, like, and they're like, stabbing each other, like, cutting their breathing tubes or whatever the hell. And it's, and like, that's really all you could do underwater. Like, there's not much else you could do.
Yeah, and it's all just shit. Slow. Like, it's just, they're not, there's no excitement to it.
Right, and it's slow because, again, you can't really move that fast underwater.
Yeah, exactly. It was a bit of a misguided sort of attempt to be exciting. I mean, I guess that just at the time, it was like, okay, we can do this, so let's do it.
Yeah, we got underwater cameras, we could do this, let's try it out.
And yeah, we haven't done this yet, so let's give it a shot.
Yeah, but, yeah, it's not that, you know, exciting anymore.
No,
I mean, by modern times, you know what I mean?
By modern times, and even by, like, the Bond standards, for just even in the Connery Bond standards, especially after coming after Goldfinger and From Russia With Love, you kind of look at it and go, this is a lot slower and less exciting.
Yeah.
And even, like, You Only Live Twice isn't perfect, it still has some craziness. And the ending is just excitement. It's just a big battle between two factions in a underground volcano lair. So it's, and that one at least has the crazy, like, accidental, not even accidental, just the racist Japanese stuff to make it at least interesting. Like, oh, this is crazy.
Yeah, like, this is so crazy.
But,
oh my God.
And, since we can't go without a Bond movie, we got to talk about these two elements. The Bond song and the Bond girl. What did you think of the Bond song?
It's fucking Tom Jones, man. I don't know. Like, it's literally...
It's nonsense.
It's absolute nonsense. I'm going to get into this in my Bond theme song feature, but holy shit, dude. Like, the lyrics are just nonsensical.
The lyrics are nonsensical, but the music is so Bond and so bombastic.
Yeah. I mean, the song itself is fine. It's just the lyrics are, you know?
Well, because there's the one part in the song. I have no knowledge of musical breakdowns, so it's just the part where, like, the song kind of slows down and does that Bond theme, and it goes, boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, the chord progression.
Yeah,
I write about that in length.
And like, that's, like, I love in a Bond song where they incorporate the Bond theme into it.
Yeah, that's because, yeah. That's the building blocks of a Bond theme. You gotta have that chord progression in there somehow.
But then, like, when you actually listen to the things he's saying, it's it's utter just gibberish.
Well, that's just Tom Jones in general, man. Like, all of his songs are just cheesy as shit. Like, they're just fun cheese, you know? Like, I don't know. It's not unusual. Like, that's such a... like, you know, it's just so corny, but it's like... It's a good song. I don't know. I enjoy it.
No, it's corny and it's a good song, but, like, when you actually listen to him, like, say, he's gonna hit you, ba-da-da-da-da, like Thunderball. It doesn't make sense within the context of the movie.
Yeah, like, what is Thunderball? They don't Do they even mention what Thunderball is in the movie? I'm pretty sure they don't.
Thunderball. Is that... That's not the boat.
No, the boat is... Fuck, what's the name of the boat? Unless I'm thinking of Never Say Never.
The boat's not Thunderball. And the bad guy's name is Largo.
Yeah.
I don't think they don't call the missiles Thunderball.
I don't think they do anything. I think it's just called Thunderball for undescript reasons.
I mean, I'm going to look at this now because this is kind of...
like,
but I mean, yeah, like... what the fuck? Thunderball.
I don't know. I don't know what it is. I think it's just like, all right, we got a title.
Because the boat is the Disco Volante, which I love.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I I don't know why it's called Thunderball. I mean, we're really bad at this. We didn't come...
We should have, yeah, looked that up. I really don't think it's mentioned in the movie, though.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
And if it is, you feel free to correct us, people who are listening. All three of you.
Two of whom are recording this.
Exactly. Yeah, man, the song, it's cheese, it's Bond-themed cheese at its finest, and it's a solid, I like it. I enjoy it, and I always love a good Tom Jones thing. And is it true that he actually passed out trying to hold that high note at the end?
I don't know if it's true. That's you know, the rumor that went around, that trying to keep that note for that long, he passed out.
See, I held it for, like, maybe a second and a half.
I'm looking at it now.
10 seconds.
They call it... It's called Thunderball because it's about nuclear bombs, and a thunderball is what they refer to the mushroom cloud.
Okay, so that
makes sense.
So he strikes like a mushroom cloud, like a nuclear weapon.
All right, that makes sense.
Yeah, I'll give you more credit now.
All right, I'm sorry, Tom. That's okay.
Sorry, Tom Jones.
You're good. I loved you in Mars Attacks.
Oh, God, that was the best.
I mean, it ends with him singing It's Not Unusual with a falcon on his arm.
one of my favorite Tim Burton movies.
Yeah, that might be the last great thing he's done.
Seriously. But for the Bond girl...
She's kind of like a blank slate, isn't she?
Domino, right?
Yeah.
I honestly thought the bad one was more interesting.
She was, right? She had a personality.
Yeah, like, she actually had, yeah, some kind of development.
Because Domino, like, Domino just kind of came out of nowhere, it seems like.
Yeah, she's just, like, there, sorta.
Which we'll get into, that Never Say Never does better with Domino.
It does do it a lot better, but it's creepier.
Oh, it's much... Well, it's all... Just in the fact that Sean Connery's, like, the age of her grandfather at that point.
Oh, God, yeah.
We'll get into that in a second, though.
Yeah, we'll get into that later.
I mean, Domino... Well, I mean, the bad one, the Spectre agent, is a lot more interesting, yeah.
Yeah, I don't remember what her name is, but she's way more interesting, and she's a lot more attractive.
Doesn't she look... I mean, do you know who Elizabeth Shue is?
Yeah.
Doesn't she look like Elizabeth Shue?
Yeah, I get that. I get that vibe. I dig it.
And, you know, watching it the other day with you, something struck me about, you know, the scene where he has sex with her, but then she reveals herself to be Spectre, and he says, oh, it was only for Queen and Country. You think I enjoyed that? And she says to him, what, did you think I was just going to turn to the side of the angels after sleeping with you? Which kind of felt like them acknowledging...
Yeah.
The thing from Goldfinger where he rapes Pussy Galore into working for him.
like they were just both like screwing each other because, you know,
like,
it
yeah,
was their
wanted...
job, not for pleasure.
Yeah, but even though it felt to me like she was like, all right, I'm going to get a little pleasure out of this guy before we get him.
Yeah.
But also just that meta moment of like, yeah, we heard the criticisms, we get it.
Yeah.
We realized this is kind of fucking crazy what he did.
Yeah. I mean, he does the same thing to the nurse, too.
Yeah, he basically blackmails her into having sex with him.
Yeah. But that the thing is, though, that these movies always imply is that they're also attracted to him. But, and it's just like he's giving them the little push that they needed to be like, oh, no, it's fine. Don't worry about it. I also want to have sex with you.
But it's also like she specifically said like a few times, I don't want to do this. I mean, it really...
I don't know. It's crazy.
It just reminds me of that fucking Family Guy joke with where they show Sean Connery. Do you want to have sex with me? No. No, 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 yes. Do you see? 50 no's and a yes means yes. Yeah, it's kind of good. But, yeah, Domino isn't very interesting or useful on almost any level, but She was hot.
She's pretty, yeah. I mean, it's a Bond movie, dude. Everyone's hot.
No, that's not all. They kind of flop around sometimes a bit with the leading girls sometimes.
Yeah, I mean, can dig that.
What was because Tomorrow Never Dies, the Bond girl is Terry Polo and mm-hmm. Michelle Yeoh.
Yeah.
Which is not like to say Michelle Yeoh's a fucking gremlin or anything, but she's not like
bombshell. She's not like strikingly beautiful.
Oh, and fucking The World Is Not Enough. You got Denise Richards, who's legitimately the only Bond girl in the entire history of Bond with fake tits. Which, kind of makes it like she's the lowest class Bond girl.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Yeah, so they don't always knock it out of the park, you know.
That's true.
But,
I mean, Denise Richards, though, is still pretty hot, I think. I mean, her acting is
atrocious.
Is absolutely horrible in that movie, but, you know.
Unreal how bad she is in that movie, but, I mean, because, like, even Pussy Galore in Goldfinger wasn't, like, the greatest thing in the world.
Yeah, true.
So at least Domino in this one was attractive, if not interesting.
Yeah, and she just kind of, I mean, really as a character, she just serves the,
She just goes with Bond.
Deus Ex Machina at the end. That's really all she kind of does.
She really just goes with the flow of whatever Bond wants to do.
Yeah. It's, I mean, Bond girls in this one. Like the villain was really cool. That was pretty much it for that.
Yeah, the villain was cool. I mean, I love that he's got an eye patch just because, you know, he's on a boat. And he's stealing shit from the ocean, so of course he's got an eye patch.
Yeah, and like that's another thing too. Like, so I feel like Mike Myers just watched Thunderball to write the first movie, the first Austin Powers movie, because there's so much stuff that like.
Oh, I mean,
it's hilarious that he just straight up stole from Thunderball.
Well, I mean, fucking. I feel like because his father was big into the Bond movies, that's why he made Austin Powers. I feel like his father had the same feelings about Thunderball your dad did, and that like, wow, I've never seen anything like this before. This is great.
Yeah.
So that probably got played a lot.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
In the Myers household.
And then eventually he probably just realized how like ridiculous some of the shit that was going on was.
Oh yeah.
Like, you know, punching the woman in the beginning. That's still one of the best Bond openings, I think.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's another thing you got to talk about. The cold open. And the cold open. Because not only do you get him knocking out what seems to be a woman.
Who is a woman.
But then we cut, and it's actually a man in disguise.
And then it's so obviously a man.
It's so obviously not the same person who was sitting there before.
It's so genius.
It's a man, baby.
Yeah, it's so genius. And then him dancing with the girl and then, like, you know, moving her in the way of the bullet.
Why won't you die?
That's another good one.
But, I mean, just from the cold open, you go from him punching the chick who's actually a guy to the jetpack, and it's like, oh, this is iconic. This is great.
Yeah.
This is the brilliant silliness of Bond that I love to see.
Exactly.
But, so overall, Thunderball kind of... We'll say overall stayed in the same position for us.
Yeah, I mean...
Because in some aspects it got better, but in some aspects it didn't, so...
Right.
It's
kind of like a...
Overall stayed the same.
Yeah, overall stayed the same, exactly.
But now to get to the unofficial remake.
Oh, man.
The unofficial Bond movie.
This one.
Never Say Never Again.
I totally forgot about this one. Like, everything about it. And it's just like... It's almost like a parody.
Oh, they definitely were taking it seriously.
Oh, God, it's genius. It's fucking genius, man. Just the quips. And just the blatant disregard for, like, you know... Sean Connery is clearly, like, a 50-year-old man.
Well, I mean...
Every single woman still wants to pork the shit out of him.
Well, that's kind of what... Yeah, they do, but I mean, it's kind of one of the smartest things they did in the movie by making his age a part of the movie, you know.
Oh yeah, no, that was like the beginning when they're like watching the tape of him
failed training exercise, yeah, the and failed it's like you're getting exercise. Old.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, they didn't do anything else with it in the rest of the movie, but just the fact that they mentioned it, you know.
Well, also the kind of opening that meta in a meta way of saying, like, you've been, oh, Bond, you've been gone for a while. We need you to do this mission. Kind of like.
Yeah, like, Connery, we need you back because.
Roger Moore's been fucking everything up.
Exactly. I also love that opening because it's just such a weird juxtaposition, like that song and just what's going on the screen. It just does not fit, but it works. It works. It's entertaining, ironically, but because it works because they were sincere with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, they were earnest.
They were earnest, and they weren't trying to make it ironic.
Yeah, they weren't being shitty.
But like you and me enjoy it ironically because of its earnestness.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But it's just so, like, I don't know, I love it.
Well, just to even talk a bit more about that opening sequence, just because it's the unofficial Bond, they don't have that format of the cold open and the theme song over the credits.
Yeah, exactly. They just kind of had that weird 007 thing.
Yeah, they kind of just had, you know, the credits play over the action with a song kind of playing over it. Without the big fanfare of, like, you know, Goldfinger or The Spy Who Loved Me. You know,
yeah,
there's
like
no,
they,
like,
they switched it up.
They kind of just made it, like, straight ahead, like, all right, the movie started, this is it now. We're not kind of cutting away to the things you expect us to do every step of the way. Even though it kind of does really just fit the Bond formula, minus the cold open and theme song.
Yeah. But It's just great, man. Like, Connery just doing his action shit, just doing his judo chops, is throwing dudes off a build, you know, shit. I just love that opening. It's him hurting everybody.
Well, just, you know, just seeing Connery, like, it seems like he was more into this one than he was into Thunderball.
Yeah, right?
He's a little more awake and aware and kind of got a little more pep in his step, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I guess because he, like, after, like, when Thunderball was happening, he was probably just like, fuck, man, like, I guess.
That was his fourth year in a row of doing a James Bond
movie.
Yeah,
and he was probably so tired of it by then.
He was tired.
In general.
He was tired. He was fighting with the producers to get more money, and he was doing all that shit for nothing, and he really just hated it after a while. And I guess, what was it, a 12-year break? Kind of. And, you know, the opportunity to fuck over the Broccolis gave him a bit pep in his step.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, he had, yeah, exactly like you said, he had all that time off, and he was probably like, yeah, you know, I could do this again. He was probably getting a hell of a check, too.
Oh, I mean, I wouldn't doubt it, especially because at that point, he was.
Yeah, exactly.
The difference between the bad guy, the Largos, of the two Largos.
They try and flesh him out more in Never Say Never.
Yeah, they give him
more of a voyeuristic creep.
Yeah, they give him more of a sort of a devious side, I guess.
Yeah, like,
because Largo is really just sort of like stock bad guy in Thunderbolt.
Exactly, he's just, you know, generic. I mean, there's really no, if you really sit there and think about it, there's no difference between him and Goldfinger.
Oh, I mean, yeah, you know? there's nothing. I think, I wouldn't have been surprised if they wanted the guy who played Goldfinger back, but something happened, because it's just the same nonsense.
It's basically the same type of character.
And, you know, I guess also just because the changes with Domino necessitated a change to Largo and Never Say Never Again, like, those two play more of a role within the story instead of that sort of ancillary role they play in Thunderball.
Yeah, exactly.
Because, like, Largo's kind of not in Thunderball a lot.
Yeah, he's not.
Like, he doesn't even really, like, see the guy until halfway through the movie. Maybe more than halfway through the movie.
And he's not even, You know, you're not, like, really rooting against him.
He's just kind of there.
Because, yeah, he's just sort of there. It's like, oh, here's the bad guy, because he has an eye patch. And
yeah.
You just know it's the bad guy. He doesn't really do anything evil. It's just because you know that he's the bad guy and that he's evil.
It's like,
you
associate
that with him.
Yeah, we've seen him in the boardroom at Spectre, so we know he's bad. There's no, you know, he's stealing nukes. Okay, he's a bad guy, whatever. But he doesn't, I don't know, he doesn't have that moment of strapping Bond to a table and about to cut his dick off.
Yeah, exactly.
He's not Red Grant, who's like, all right, I've been watching you this whole time, so I can personally kill you.
Yeah, exactly.
He's just, you know, he's there. He's even less, like, I guess, threatening than Dr. No.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, I mean, Dr. No, you have, like, a build-up to him. And
well,
his
yeah,
titles there's... and the name, so you're just, who is this guy? I want to know who he is.
Yeah, there's the mystery. What's going on? So there's a reason you don't know who, you don't have anything to latch on to. Here, it's like,
Here's
Largo. All right, we're not going to see him for a while. Here he is again. He's not really doing much.
Yeah. Here he is. Yeah, I don't know. But in Never Say Never, they actually tried to make him, like, you know.
I actually, you know, like Largo and Never Say Never Again more than, you know, I think it worked. It, you know, especially because of the whole having to do all the stuff with Domino. That aspect of the movie is better in Never Say Never than it is in Thunderball.
Yeah.
The villain and Bond girl aspect of it.
Yeah, and the whole thing, I mean, the reason that... It's kind of fucked up, was like the reason that he seeks her out is really just because she's super hot.
Oh,
I mean Bond, he just sees her like dancing on a boat and he's like, all right, yeah, like I'm just gonna do my thing.
This
and he ropes her into a spy plot somehow.
Yeah, and I mean, also, I guess, you know what else this movie has over Thunderball is the action's better, I guess, you know?
Oh, yeah. Well, there's significantly less scuba sequences.
Well, yeah, I mean, yes, oh my god. The ending alone, you can tell the difference, just...
Yeah.
They condense everything they were trying to do at the end of Thunderball into like, alright, we know what's happening, we know what's gotta be done, let's move this shit along.
Yeah.
And, it's almost 20 years later, technology's moved up a bit, you don't have as much speed... ramping nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, but I mean, I don't know. Also, just because you were talking about it when we were watching Thunderball, how much more convoluted the plan with the bombs is in Never Say Never Again.
Oh yeah, like the way they get the bombs is just they just deliver them, kind of. They just shoot the bombs out. Well, no, yeah, it's like this whole fucking thing. Like, they get the guy to do the bait and switch, which they do in Thunderball also. And, you know, instead of just taking the bombs from a plane like they did in Thunderball, they actually launch the bombs, and then I didn't even really understand it. Like, I guess they get the bombs to land in the ocean next to this boat that may not have magnets or something. I don't even understand it. It's just really, like...
It's very convoluted.
Yeah, it just doesn't make... It's like, all right, you could have just had them take a fucking boat or something, and it could have been way easier.
Yeah, yeah. And just even going into that, I guess the odd inclusion of Max von Sydow as Blofeld.
Well, I know. It doesn't make any... Because I would have loved to have seen him interact with Bond.
Well, yeah. I don't know if there was any plans to have them interact, or, like, even if there were plans for sequels or anything.
That's the other thing.
But I know there was a lot of footage that was cut out of this movie. Like, I think something up to, like, an hour of footage or something.
Shit, really?
Maybe less. I might be, like, rounding up. But, a significant amount of footage got cut out, and I know a lot of his footage got cut out.
Yeah.
So, I mean, So, obviously, his role was more substantial, but... To what end is something I'm kind of interested in seeing, you know? I mean,
yeah, like, did they want to make, I just don't know. If they want to make more sequels with Connery and Sydow, or they just kind of, maybe they had an ending?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean,
with Blofeld in there?
I don't know, man.
Because Max von Sydow, I mean, you know, he's got the reputation of being this great actor and, you know, a very arty actor who's worked with Bergman, but who's also worked with, like, in The Exorcist. But he is a guy who will just do a job.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it is still odd, because he's not Donald Pleasance level of just, yeah, whatever you offer me, I'll do it. To just even make the effort to get him.
Yeah,
and just
right?
sort of not really use him is odd, but I mean,
it really might have just been that they had plans and they were hoping for it to succeed, and unfortunately, it didn't. Octopussy made more money.
Well, you know, that's Octopussy made more money, yeah, but it's not like Never Say Never was a failure. It did make a lot of its money. It made more than its budget by a lot.
Yeah,
but I guess also just. I don't know, it honestly might have been a legal thing where, yeah, he's got Kevin McClory's got Spectre and he's got Blofeld and he can use Bond. It might have been legal nonsense would have been so much more like complicated to go ahead with it, because you even look at some of the stuff with Bond later, like there's a 6-year gap between License to Kill and GoldenEye because Kevin McClory sued him again.
Yeah.
And, You know.
I read some stuff that said, like, he kept trying to make movies. Like, he kept trying to make more Bond movies, but for whatever reason, he just couldn't get them off the ground. I mean, whether it be financial or, you know, because of legal shit, I don't really know.
Well, I guess just, like, they obviously had the evidence that having a second Bond flick would not succeed against the main series.
Yeah.
I know in the 90s, Sony, because MGM had the official Bond at the time, and that Sony was going to make a second Bond franchise with McClory, but that just didn't work out. So it seemed like for a long time they were trying to make a second Bond series, but shit just didn't work out. I mean, it's odd how that shit would have it's weird how the whole Kevin McClory, this whole situation really changed the franchise for a long time.
Yeah.
Because the Roger Moore series basically had to just completely ignore everything and do its own thing. No Spectre, no Blofeld, and just sort of have no continuity at all. Because you people think about Bond, you don't think continuity, but those first... From Dr. No to Diamonds Are Forever, even with Lazenby in the middle there, there was this build-up with Spectre.
Yeah.
Like, you don't even meet Blofeld. You don't see his face until the fifth one.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy.
So, like, they basically had to throw all continuity out the window. And then you even look, when Moore's gone, that... You Only Live For Your Eyes Only was supposed to be his last one, and that they wanted Brosnan, but then they brought
Dalton.
They brought Moore back for Octopussy and A View to a Kill, and that Dalton came in because Brosnan was going to, but then his TV show fucked him over and renewed it, so he couldn't do it.
Right.
But that Kevin McClory again with that lawsuit kept Dalton away for 6 years. That he could have done a third Bond movie, but that lawsuit basically just lasted too long. And he said, I can't do this anymore. I'm like an old man.
Yeah, and then he died in like 2001, I think. Or no, I think it was 2006.
Yeah, Kevin McClory died maybe, I think, yeah, around the time of Casino Royale.
Yeah, and then and after that, it was like, all right, cool, we could use this, we could use Spectre now.
Well, it was only 2 years ago, it was like, I guess the family must have made a deal, or the courts just said, all right, Kevin McClory's dead, so you guys can use the rights exclusively now.
Yeah.
But, yeah, you look at it, and Brosnan would have been, you know, Dalton could have been Bond longer, so Brosnan may never have even been Bond.
Yeah, it's crazy to think about it that way.
And because of the lawsuits, the Craig movies had to make up their own foe, Spectre, that's now being tied in to the new movie.
Which is Quantum, right?
Yeah, Quantum. And now Quantum's being used as sort of like this group that got squashed by Spectre.
Oh, okay. That's how they're going to explain it? That's cool.
It seems like it from what I can tell, but it's just how that one lawsuit reverberated for like 40 years. It's so bizarre and led to a lot of weird shit in the franchise.
Yeah, I mean, even just the idea, just think about that for a second. Like, being, like, you know, obviously in the 80s there was really no outlets for people to talk about movies or anything. But just imagine, like, just being, living in, like, being in 83, like, being, you know, like a 20-year-old guy, and knowing that two different Bond movies are going to come out. In the same year, by two different studios. That would be, like, I guess today, if, you know, Sony decided they were going to release a Spider-Man movie, and then Marvel released a Spider-Man movie at the end of the year.
Well, no, I mean, honestly, it would be like if Siegel and Shuster's family successfully got the rights to Superman back.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then they were making a rival Superman movie at, like, 20th Century Fox, but WB was still going ahead with Batman versus Superman.
Yeah, it's just like, what the hell, man? Yeah. It would come out the same year. This is a crazy concept to me. Like, the internet would just be on fire about it, you know?
It's such an odd moment in history, and, you know, and especially kind of momentous event in the Bond franchise that, I mean, it's even kind of crazy that they even survived after a lot of those kind of crazy changes that kind of had to be necessitated after losing all those rights.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts. I'm glad they got it back because, you know, I want to see Christoph Waltz as not Blofeld, probably.
Even though he's probably Blofeld.
Even though he absolutely fucking is Blofeld. Jesus Christ. I can't believe that's just become the new thing. Just straight up lie.
Well, that's the thing now in the day of the internet where literally everything can leak. It's just like, no, this is bullshit, no. And then just be like, oh no, yeah, this is actually what's happening. We lied to you guys, right? Aren't you surprised? No. Fuck
We're
you.
Not surprised.
I don't know. I mean, you know, we'll see. I feel like there's going to be something where it's not as Star Trek Into Darkness as we think it's going to be.
Yeah, we'll see, man. I don't know. I'm honestly very pumped for it.
I feel like, honestly, he might actually be a guy called Oberhauser, which is what they're calling him. But that, by, like, the end of the movie, he takes the name Blofeld to, like, go into hiding.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
I feel like something more is going on, but, you know, we'll see.
We shall.
It's soon enough. But, I mean, is there really anything else you want to talk about? Anything that you thought about watching them? Something you want to mention, I guess?
Mr. Bean was in this. Never Say Never, like, mad randomly.
Yeah, he was.
Like, mad fucking randomly. I did not expect that.
It was bizarre.
I don't even know, man. He just shows up. It's kind of weird.
Yeah, it's just also that, you know, from the guy who directed The Empire Strikes Back, he is Never Say Never Again.
Yeah, right? Irvin Kershner.
But,
I think Kim Basinger was a better,
Domino, yeah.
Better Domino.
Yeah, she was better.
And the other girl... the Spectre agent girl.
Yeah.
It was a lot weirder in this one. Like, there's the one scene, like, to kill the guy, the double, she literally throws a fucking snake in the car.
Yeah.
Which I thought was brilliantly cheesy. And then she has that whole weird thing with Bond, like, how, like, you know, she wants to be the best that he ever had. And she makes it write it down. And then he conveniently kills her with a pen.
Yeah, that got a little weirder, yeah.
Yeah, it was weird. Like, you write down, like, you know, whatever her name is, was the best you ever had. And I was like, Jesus Christ, this girl's fucking weird. And then they kind of brought that back, too, with the Russian chick in GoldenEye. But not as, like, blatantly cheesy.
Xenia on the top.
Yeah, Xenia on the top. What's her name?
Famke Janssen.
That's it, Famke. She's got some freaking crazy name.
She's Dutch.
It took me the longest time to, like, put two and two together that she was Jean Grey. Because yeah. She looks totally different in GoldenEye than she does as Jean Grey.
Yeah, she does look a little different, yeah.
Like, she's just so much younger. Unless maybe she got, like, some plastic surgery done or some shit. I don't know. Or it could just be the red hair. But yeah, for the what would you say? Which one do you like more?
I mean, honestly, if I gotta say, if I had to watch one again, it would be Never Say Never. It's a lot easier to watch, and it moves quicker. Thunderball's like cooler, you know. It's got that cool tone.
Yeah.
But I mean, yeah, I think I'd watch Never Say Never again before I watch Thunderball again.
Yeah, you know, I kind of feel the same way. Like, overall, Never Say Never is just like, you know, it's fun. It's very, you know, it's cheesy. It goes quicker, like you said. I think Thunderball, obviously, is more historically important.
Yeah.
Just because of, you know, all those classic moments of the frickin' the jetpack, him punching the woman, and... You know, all that stuff. But, oh yeah, I agree with you. Overall, I'd probably, you know, if I had to pick one of the two to watch again, I'd probably just watch Never Say Never. Because yeah. It's, you know, just like you said, it flows better. And it's fun to watch.
Yeah, I think it's, it's just overall a more complete package, I guess.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess that should do it for this first episode of this new podcast we're doing, guys.
Woohoo!
But yeah, so Thunderball, Never Say Never Again is done. Stay tuned for the next episode, which should be in about a week, where we will be looking at the Craig trilogy.
Yes, we and, will.
And also just in advance, just so you guys can catch up if you'd like, because it's a big episode. The week after that will be the first 7 Bond movies, since they all tie into Spectre. And the Blofeld character.
Yeah, that's going to take a while, but we got it. We're going to take care of it.
Well, think of it this way. We already got Thunderball down.
Yeah, right? It's one less one to watch.
That's one less one to watch. I just watched Diamonds Are Forever because I read the book and did that post.
Mm-hmm.
So we got 2 weeks. You have 2 weeks to get through 6, and I have 2 to get through 5.
And I have to, yeah.
And I have to watch From Russia With Love next anyway because I'm reading the book now.
Yep.
And, yeah, basically...
We'll take care of it. I mean, now I'm, like, for the most part, I'm done moving most of my shit in.
Yeah,
my new place, so I'll be settling down, which would be nice. And I'll be able to sit down and enjoy all these flicks.
And since you tend to work weekends mostly, the weekend's about done, you could watch a good deal of movies soon.
Oh, absolutely.
But, yeah, so... thanks for listening, guys. Tune in next week. Check out the website, popculturallyinsensitive.com. I just put up a review of Bone Tomahawk and the book review of Diamonds Are Forever. Anthony's got a Jurassic Park comparison coming up within the week.
Yes, sir.
And as he said, is working on the Bond theme article.
Oh, yeah. It's a lot. It's... God, this first part is going to be... me being very bitter because a lot of these songs are shit.
Trust me, I know. And at some point he'll also probably get back to the Kubrick thing, which I saw was very popular with you guys.
Yes, thank you guys. That was awesome.
But yeah, for now, thanks again for listening, and we'll see you soon. Bye.
Peace.